गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी शैल डिस्कस द इम्पॉर्टेंट पैसेज फॉर एक्सप्लेनेशन फ्रॉम द मर्चेंट ऑफ वेनिस फ्रॉम द एक्ट फिफ्थ. देर इज नो सीन एट ऑल इन द एक्ट फिफ्थ. वी हैव ओनली द एक्ट, नो सीन्स आर देयर. इट मीन्स वी हैव ओनली वन सीन इन दिस एक्ट. This is the last act that we are doing. This one is the one explanation, and then we have another passage for the second explanation from this act. Thereafter, this play will be finished, will be completed as far as the important extracts for explanations are concerned. I am sure that through these explanations we have also understood the whole story or the plot or the complexities of the plots, dramatic significance of the scenes and acts, etc. throughout the play. So in our next lecture we will be completing this play. After then we will discuss some important issues regarding this play, some important questions you might have. But for now, let's go with this text that is from Act 5th. Look how the floor of heaven is thick inlaid with patterns of bright gold. There is not the smallest orb which thou beholdest, but in his motion, like an angel sings, is still quivering to the young-eyed cherubims. Such harmony is in immortal souls, but whilst this muddy vesture of decay doth grossly close it in, we cannot hear it. We have some difficult words in this passage, so I am giving you the meaning of those difficult words first, then we will go with the meaning of the passage as well as the context of the passage, where it has been said and why it has been said and by whom it has been said. So the first word is patens here, patens of bright gold. Patens means thin metal plates. That here it has been used for the stars of the sky. So the stars are looking like the thin metal plates. Motion, that is the movement, as the Elizabethans believed that as the planets moved, they created heavenly harmony. Quivering means singing together. Young-eyed cherubims means angels whose eyes are always young. Cherubim means angels. Vesture of decay, that is the human body, clothing of mortality. So vesture of decay refers to the human body. Grossly means roughly. So according to me, these were some of the words of this passage that I have given you the meaning. Now we come to the reference and context. We know up to now what has happened so far. We saw the court of the Duke where the case of the Psylog was heard, and in which Portia as a lawyer succeeded the case in the favor of Antonio, and a punishment and a penalty was imposed upon Shylock. That is, half of his property was given to the estate and half the other half of his property was given to his daughter Jessica. We also know that Jessica had eloped with Lorenzo, who was the servant of Shiloh. So after having won the case, we saw in the court that Antonio and Bassanio, as well as Gratianio, they all were feeling very gratitude and thankful to the lawyer Portia and Nerissa. Nerissa was clerk there. Portia was the judge or a lawyer there. So they wanted to give something to them as a token for thanks. So they wanted to give 3,000 ducats to Portia, but Portia refused to take them. And when they forced her to take something, she very cleverly asked them to give the rings that they have worn in their fingers and which were given by their wives. And who were the wives? Portia to Bassanio Nerissa. Nerissa to the Gratianio. They knew Portia and Nerissa, they knew that the rings they gave them, and they also made them to take a pledge that they will not leave or remove those rings, because that were the token of their love, and they did that promise also. So here they wanted, or they were testing their husbands, because no one was recognizing them. So they asked for those rings. They said that if they wanted to give something, they would like to have those rings only, nothing else. They would not be pleased with anything else except the rings. In this way, the situation happened that both Bassanio and Gratianio, Bassanio gave his ring to Portia and Gratianio gave the ring to Nerissa. And then Portia and Nerissa left the Venice and set for Belmont. That is, they departed for Belmont. Now this act, fifth act, is the scene is of the Belmont. We are now moving to Belmont. And who are there? Because Portia and Nerissa had gone, so who were the left there behind them? Jessica and Lorenzo. Both were there at the home. They were keeping the safeguard of their home. So this is the talk. These lines are the talk between Jessica and Lorenzo. And they are sitting in the moonlit garden of Portia's house in Belmont. So the time is of night. The moon is shining in the sky. And the moonlit, that is the light of the moon, is shining the whole world. And they are sitting in the garden. So they are feeling very cool, calm, peace. And they are enjoying that environment, that atmosphere. And they are also feeling good. So they are waiting for a fine welcome home to Portia. That is, they are waiting for Portia and Nerissa, that they will come to the home with a good news. So they were waiting for their fine welcome. So when they were waiting, Lorenzo, because he had an artist soul, so the soul of rhythm is awakened in him, just as much as in Jessica by the moonlight scene. So the scene of the moonlight aroused in them the rhythm of the music, the rhythm of the song, the rhythm of pleasure, the rhythm of love, the rhythm of affection in their souls. So here they are talking each other, and Lorenzo is pointing out in these lines that what's happening in the sky at that time. So he says, he points out to Jessica the beauty of the sky. So the beautiful sky at that time in the night, चाँद की चांदनी से पूरा विश्व जो है कि जगमगा रहा था, पूरा आकाश जगमगा रहा था तारों से, चांद से. तो ये जो ब्यूटी ऑफ द स्काई थी, उसको वो उसको पॉइंट आउट करता है कि लुक एट द ब्यूटी ऑफ द स्काई इज स्टडीड विद एन इन्यूमरेबल स्टार्स. सो द इन्यूमरेबल स्टार्स आर शाइनिंग इन द स्काई एट दैट टाइम, एंड अदर हेवनली बॉडीज आर एज वेल एज शाइनिंग, नॉट ओनली द स्टार्स बट अदर हेवनली बॉडीज, एंड दे लुक लाइक स्मॉल डिस्क और प्लेट्स ऑफ गॉड. दीज ऑल स्टार्स, हेवनली बॉडीज, दे ऑल लुकिंग वेरी स्मॉल, दे आर लुकिंग एज इफ दे आर द स्मॉल डिस्क और द प्लेट्स ऑफ गोल्ड शाइनिंग, बिकॉज दे आर शाइनिंग, देयर कलर इज गोल्ड. So here, Lorenzo is comparing the stars and heavenly bodies with a small disc or plates of gold. And that is beautiful nazara, jisko apan keh sakte hain, seen in the sky. The heavenly bodies are producing an enchanting music. So heavenly bodies are not only shining, but they are in that way, in this way, they are producing an enchanting music, delighting music, capturing music, capturing the soul and mind up there while they are moving in their orbits. So when these heavenly bodies are moving on their in their orbits, apne अपनी धुरी पर, अपने अक्ष पर जब ये घूम रही होती हैं, दे आर प्रोड्यूसिंग अ काइंड ऑफ म्यूजिक विच इज एनचेंटिंग, विच इज अट्रैक्टिव, विच इज कैप्चरिंग द माइंड एंड द सोल. एंड हियर लॉरेंजो अगेन कंपेयरिंग विद दिस मूवमेंट विद द बैंड ऑफ सिंगर्स इन अ चर्च, एज इफ अ बैंड ऑफ सिंगर्स इन द चर्च हु आर moving and singing, or as the cherubims or angels sing song in heaven, as if the angels are singing song in the heaven in worship of the various gods. So angels are singing songs in the heaven, in the sky, in order to please their gods, various gods, in order to worship of their various goats. Then Lorenzo further tells to Jessica that this heavenly music, so this is not the earthly music that we have, but this is heavenly music. There is difference between heavenly music and earthly music, our music, ethereal music. So this heavenly music is only audible to the heavenly creatures. So only heavenly creatures can hear this heavenly music, this mysterious music, who are immortal. So heavenly creatures are always immortal. He means to say that we mortal beings, we the human beings who are living on the earth, cannot hear that heavenly music, that heavenly song.
So not to the human beings or other living creatures. Because why? Why we can't hear? Because we creatures on the earth are imprisoned in the bodies. And these bodies are inevitable to death. That is, the body of our beings is immortal. The bodies are mortal. We are the mortal beings. We are to go to death, which are frail, and we are subject to decay and decline. One day we have to die. So we creatures are not immortal. We are mortal. So we cannot hear this heavenly music because it can only be heard by the heavenly creatures, and they are immortals. And in the last, Lorenzo tells that human beings or other living creatures on the earth are freed from the bondage. So he means to say that we living creatures on this earth, we the human beings on this earth, can hear the music of the heavenly bodies. We can catch, we will be able to catch the music of the heavenly bodies only when we are freed from the bondage of the bodies. That is, until we are in the bodies, in the bondage of body, we cannot hear that music, that heavenly music. When we are free from this body, that is, the body, we will free this body when we die. Then our souls will fly into the sky or will join the heavenly bodies. Only then we will be able to hear that musical sounds or that music. Upon this earth, we cannot hear. This is what Lorenzo wants to say here through these lines. So this is the passage that we have done, and you should know very well that Lorenzo and Jessica, both of them love each other, and they are enjoying this environment. They are happy because very soon Portia and Nerissa were to reach there, and they will listen a good news from them, and then they also hope that they will also get married. So it is now going to be a happy ending. Now the climax of this comedy is over, and everyone is in a good mood, in a rejoicing mood. In the next passage, we will see the end of this play with a happy ending. Everyone will be happy. This was the Ring episode that is still running here. So this passage refers to the doctrine of the music of the spheres taught by Pythagoras. So the Pythagoras also gave this doctrine that these planets, these heavenly bodies, when they move, they create a heavenly music, although we human beings on this earth cannot hear. But there is the music in the sky or in this universe, and it has also been verified by Pythagoras. The doctrine has been described by Plato in the Republic, and this doctrine has been also mentioned, has been described, has been analyzed by Plato in the Republic. The Republic is the name of the book written by Plato in a dialogue form. Each planet in its revolution was supposed to produce a certain note. So even these ancient philosophers, they also were in the view that each planet
in this sky, in this universe, when it revolves, it also makes a certain kind of music or a note. And here poetry is full of allusions to get to the great sphere, music of stars and constellations. So our poetry is full of all these imaginations, all these comparisons, all these allusions about the stars and constellations. Many poets have described about the stars, about the moons, about the sun, about the other inhabitants, or we can say the heavenly bodies of the universe in their creations. So this is what, dear friends, we have for today, and I hope you will enjoy it. For now, thank you very much, and we shall meet you with another and the last passage from this play in our next lecture. Till then, bye bye. Thank you very much.